Welcome to this edition of Chat with Chair. We are extremely privileged and delighted to have Mr. Ravishankar Pandey, Managing Director of Hela Lighting Limited. He also chairs the Road Safety Subcommittee of FICCI. And I would like to extend a very warm welcome to him in this session with Chat with Chair. Thank you for joining. Despite your recovering from COVID, but just for the viewers, Mr. Ravishankar Pandey is one of the youngest CEOs. He is the Managing Director of Hela India Lighting Limited since 2010, so it'll be 11 years now. Additional to his Managing Director role, he has a global role in Hela Germany for the special OE division, the original equipment division, where he works very closely with the US market. He is a winner of the Asia Pacific Entrepreneurship Award in 2016 in the promising category. He is alumni of NIT Calicut, ICFI Hyderabad, and IIM Bangalore. He has also completed IMA's flagship Global Advanced Management Program by the University of California, Berkeley at Silicon Valley. His 18 years of entrepreneurial experience and turnaround experience in the auto component industry. He's worked in both OEM and aftermarket industry fields. He's worked in both Bosch and Timken. His core area of interest is technology and people development. As mentioned, he is also serving as the chairman Road Safety Subcommittee at FICCI and the chairman aftermarket committee at the Auto Component Manufacturers Association of India, ACMA. He's a passionate advocate of road safety, and you'll hear more of that as we discuss. So very warm welcome to you, Mr. Pandey, to this session of Chat with Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Chinnai. Pleasure.
So, you have been advocating this whole, it's a national movement. It's a citizens' movement, actually, on road safety. And, why did you actually initiate this, and what got you to doing that?
See, when you see today, I belong to automotive industry, and whether at Bosch or at Hela, it's very clear when we see the sensitivity towards this topic in mass and in numbers, which speaks for itself that the automobile industry itself is not sustainable if we do not stop this. If you look at in past, rivers used to be the major, channel of transportation, and now it's road transportation. So road transportation is key to all of us, and precisely the whole, if you look at our rehabilitation, we all are around the road transportation. Now, the issue is every day in India, 415 family does not get back their people home. Can you just keep it without notice? We should not arrest this, alarming high numbers. So what it appeal is, there are a lot of solutions for this. And these solutions can come from technology, they can come from a citizen movement, and we are very close to a solution. So problem is large. You have every minute one crash, you have every 4 minute one fatality. And then I see a solution which is very, very close. And these solutions, if put together by the whole citizens, the way today for COVID, we all are working together. If you all work together, I think we can eliminate road crash from this country. But that belief what I have is it's possible. There are solutions. We just have to come together. The vision is already there also from Ministry of Road Transport and many, many organizations. Everybody is working. We just have to come together. So if you ask me why I came into this, I saw an opportunity of making a difference and a huge satisfaction that we have made this social problem solved. And that's also in my company. We gave a vision statement which says technology of tomorrow for the life of today on Indian roads. So we all started, eating, drinking, sleeping with this topic that it's possible. And that's how the whole passion came in our team. We work at FICCI with the same passion again at ACMA, at SIAM, all across. In the end, I can only tell you that the desire to solve this, the passion to see that it is really getting can be eliminated and India can be free from all road crashes is bringing me here.
So, if you relate it, in the current pandemic to this other health crisis that you faced is this road accidents. How serious is this issue on our roads, and what are the major contributing factors?
So, if you compare even one to one, you have more than 1.5 lakh fatality every year in road crashes. Every year, it's not a year or two. If you look at the whole decade, it's more than 1.7 million. Now, that's a huge number. Nowhere in India, in any war or anything, so much fatalities happen. But this is a silent killer. And because it's a silent killer, there is less, I will say, public importance to it. It's not politically very important. People do not give vote to solve this problem. You don't see this in the manifesto of political party. And that's why it is more, you know, crucial to attack, because it is a silent killer. And now, when you asked me how big is the issue, it is actually very big on global level also. 3,700 people fatality per day, you know, across the world. More than if I look at injured people, is again huge. You can just, you know, the numbers are really, you have handicapped people. Now, as you rightly said, the root cause, I think it's a complex science. You know, crash is a very, very complex science, where you have the vehicle, you have the road users interaction, you have the infrastructure, which is the road itself, and the vehicle is run by a human. Now you can imagine how much variable they are. And that's why it becomes a very complex topic. Now, it will be very difficult to generalize the root causes. There are many, many reasons for road crashes. But what I believe is, even when we have many, many reasons, infrastructure has to improve, you know, the regulation on the safety of cars has to improve, the training of the driver has to, all of this is there. But at the spot of a crash, most important person is the driver. Now, can we at least start first thing first? And that is why I say, jab hum badlenge, to desh badlega. So even before we get to root cause by crash analysis and all those, one thing which we all can do as a citizens, like in COVID we are doing, we all come together and we say, okay, I will be the change. I will make distance between cars and vehicles on road. I will drive in lane. I will have helmets. I will have seat belts. Only by doing that citizens movement, the first major chunk is possible. Because in our country, when enforcement is so low, I don't think we can manage with the 80,000 police force or traffic police, a billion Indian who are violating, you know, on the roads to streamline. And that's where the idea to start and begin with it, jab hum badlenge to desh badlega, why not we all be the change and start our responsibility on the road.
Very interesting. You know, like COVID, we know we need to maintain social distancing, we need to wear a mask, we need to sanitize. You're also saying that safe distance, you know, lane, and you know,
same SMS. You have the safe distance, you have the mask, helmets, you have the like sanitizer you are using here. Here also you need to keep your vehicle safe, fit. I think it's very similar, which if everyone starts, we can save that.
So, what can we learn? You've talked about all the, challenges and the multiple problems in the different aspects, whether it's road, whether it is vehicle safety, whether it is driver behavior. But what is it can we learn from global best practices, and how do we fast track that in India?
You know, the biggest thing globally we can see is, today we are learning quite a lot. Of course, regulations are all, India is on a very high level. You know already at Siam, you have seen, as of today, India has really upgraded its safety standard for vehicles. So there we are already globally very, very on the benchmark. The problem is our traffic conditions are completely different. We have more than 80% two-wheelers. And because we have more than 80% two-wheeler, the flow on the road, the dynamics, the analysis of our road behavior is completely different. So from the system approach, what is the global approach? Which says system approach is even humans will make mistakes. So let's accept that. I think that is something which we can learn from them, which is called Vision Zero or the safe system approach, that humans are bound to make mistakes, but that should not penalize that heavily. We should have ways and means to reduce these crashes and the fatality. Now, having said that, we don't have crash analysis in our country in a matured way. So we need to augment that with our need, where we have more than 80% two-wheeler they are all not trained. All of them can get license without training, right? So majority of the vehicle drivers are on a different level of understanding the dynamics on the road. And that's why we need to install our own crash analysis. I think ICAT has started. That's a good starting point. And we need to capture all this data, because if you don't know cause and effect, what are we trying to do? It's so great. I tell you one example of just a beam aligner. From Hella, we sell quite a lot. Now, if you ask people, they don't use the beam aligner on the low beam to reduce to a level. They see it's only high beam, low beam. There's nothing called fine tuning. And they all have the 0, 1, 2, 3. Now, there's a regulation, there's a technology, and everybody will complain it's a glare. Yes, it will be a glare, because when you have more load in the boot, the vehicle goes like this. And now these simple things needs education. These simple things needs local adoption. So in India, if you have regulation very strong, enforcement zero, result is zero. And that is where we have to take citizen participation, because enforcement is not possible anyway to a democratic country. And we have only 80,000 traffic police. And that's where the Andolan has to come, that movement has to come. FICCI is doing great there. I think our committee has taken up in subcommittees that we need to take corporates together. Organizations together. Every individual is related to some organization. Why not organization take it? Just like ISO 9000, TS 14, why not everybody takes this as a protocol and say everybody has a code of conduct in their HR handbook. Everybody ensures that they are rewarded well when they are behaving well, and everybody penalized when they are not behaving well. I think with everybody coming together, we can make a soft enforcement. You can call it self-enforcement. Only with self-enforcement, then we'll be able to come out of it.
I think I'm very interested in your corporate handbook. So if you were to take a car, right, what should corporates insist on the driver, on the occupants of the car? What will it actually help everybody, if they were following the self-regulation?
There's a very interesting 7.8 point code of conduct made by FICCI also in India against road crash. I think this is available also on the... So if you take that pledge, that 8-point pledge, very simple 8-point pledge, covers 90% topics.
But just to share with the thing, like for example, should all occupants in the car wear seatbelts?
Starts with simple thing. First is all the restraint system, seatbelt. You have your buckles with the helmet. You have the child restraint system. So all the restraint system is number one. You need to buckle up. Number two is you need to respect speed. Speed is something, it's not about you can't speed more, but speed is contextual. So please understand where you have no lane system, where you have the median and the two-wheelers are coming. I think you need to respect the braking distance. Braking distance is not in your hand. It is a physics. So this has to be understood. So speed is something which is very, very crucial. I'll say number three after that is, we are looking at drink and drive as a major factor. So this is something where bolte nashe ki halat mein kabhi nahi chalana hai. So this has to be in the code of conduct definitely. Other than this, what I remember, the vehicle fitness is also very, very crucial. The other one is right of way, because when you don't give right of way, you create a mess. So the lane system, the right of way becomes very crucial. Simple thing. You don't have to have a full driving training, but right of way will save a lot of people. It's also very, very important. Other than this, I think in the vehicle fitness, even the high beam, low beam will come. So we have also factored that. Do you remember something more?
No. So I think out of the 7 things that you talked about, you've highlighted the key ones. Buckle up, respect speed, don't drink and drive, follow lane discipline, give a right of way, and make sure that you use the technology that has been given, especially the example of high beam, low beam that you gave. So be respectful of oncoming traffic and ensure that they are also there. So I think this is
one important thing on the lane driving. On lane driving will be a very important thing is the 2 second distance, safe distance. 2 to 3 seconds, you should always keep distance between vehicle. This is the crucial thing. In India, it is 600 microseconds, and that's a huge issue. You have more than 45% crashes happening tailgating. Right. The reason is, if you go abroad, you see clearly, even when the traffic slows down, there's a gap. And everybody slows down with this 2 to 3 second gap. Just like you have the do gaj ki duri, I think duri has zaruri also on sarak par, I say. The distance has to be maintained also on the road.
So if you were to look at India as a country, you know, one, you talked about what corporates could do. What are the top three interventions that we as a country could do in solving this problem?
I think the biggest thing is, first is the crash analysis. We must invest into this. And based on that crash analysis, the IRC code, because our roads have to be different. Our roads have to be as per our requirement, because our people are different. Our traffic patterns are different. This investment into simulating that, I think it's very important. We can get funding also. I think before we start making so many roads, we have to make safe roads. So the audit of the roads are the number two. So one is starting with the crash analysis. Second is the either IRAP rating, minimum IRAP rating or something has to be done for all roads. If you ensure this too, and then everybody, you know, makes a citizen movement, just three of it, I think we'll eliminate.
I think that's a very interesting thing. And also, you know, you mentioned about the Indian driving thing. So a lot of the technology should be tested and adapted to Indian driving conditions. It not necessarily, you know, what is what the timings and the adaptation speed and other physics that you talked about, which is applicable in let's say the advanced countries, is particularly applicable to India. So I think that's very...
Dilip, for example, if you see, our trucks will always be in the overtaking lane. We overtake from everywhere. If we horn, that means I am free to go anywhere. Our lane is different. So if you look at, these are very, this is reality. We have to accept that. System approach says accept the situation as it is and then intervene, not become idealistic and nothing will happen. This is what we are trying to do. If you copy Sweden to India, I think if Indian situation is similar to Sweden, they will have problems.
So if I were to say that, you know, you've been leading this effort and, you know, for the last few years, we've done a lot of innovative things. We bought out books for children. We have done road marches. So, you know, what are the major roadmap, you know, at the FICCI subcommittee on road safety that you are thinking of? And what do you think will really actually create an impact on solving this national problem?
What we have done at FICCI, we have made a few subgroups. Corporates have come together, like-minded corporates who want to work in that area. One is in the vehicle area, whether Mahindra or Tata, everybody put together, Hella, Intel. There we are talking about intelligent systems. Because you have to also understand that blaming the driver is not going to solve the problem. Driver is the only person they are going to help you to save there. Whatever he is, whatever his capacity is down, you have to build the capability of that driver. And that's why it's rather than control by regulation and zero enforcement, convert that into alert and assist. So alert the driver timely, assist the driver. I think we will definitely, just like in a plane, the air hostess comes and says, wear your seatbelt. I think everybody does that. People may forget, but you don't go for chalan. And then you incentivize that. And that's why we say na to chalan ke liye, na to jhooti saan ke liye. Many, many of these interventions for apne aur apno ki jaan ke liye. So kahin na kahin unko inaam bhi hum de sakte hain, recognize bhi kar sakte hain. So this group of people are making a lot of these intelligent systems in the vehicle. One group of people is working on behavior of the road user. And this is where the campaigns like India Against Road Crash, campaigns like Safe Speed Challenge, which was inaugurated during the Road Safety Month. Going forward, we have this app called India Against Road Crash. On this app, anybody can download and anybody can see how good he is driving. There's a very interesting 3,50,000 potholes mapped. And if you get that signal, please slow down. If you're slowing down with the alert, you're a good driver. You get bonus. I think currently all the results are being published on the social media that how we encourage people to do good. So this is the second group, which is on behavior. And this behavior has to be monitored. It is not just such training and forget it. It has to have a loop. So every corporate can install that. They can have their own app, doesn't matter. But they can monitor. Today, mobile has so much thing to support, alert and assist. So that's the second group. The third group is working on infrastructure where we want to do pilots and give it to government to scale it up. Those are the three major topics we have taken. For school kids, we are going all out because there we find that at least that generation will come up very nicely. After that book distribution, we are actually going to school by school and corporate by corporate for their connect to kids. And we have this training module called Duri Hai Zaruri. This Duri Hai Zaruri, the idea is to have 1 million training done online. And we are doing it.
That's very ambitious. And thank you for leading that program. Now, just, you know, to end, I just want to come back and, you know, talk about the current situation. So as a managing director and you're running a whole company, What COVID appropriate behavior have you introduced in your company when it is operational? I'd like you to share that with the viewers.
I think it's very important. Corporates have a huge responsibility. We have people in the plant, in offices. First major thing is that, again, be the change. So whoever has any, you know, signal, any, I'm telling, when you are already having some symptom, I think isolating, declaring, talking, rather than hiding. This is one major thing I've seen to restrict spread in the company. And that has helped us quite a lot. So we have encouraged people to do that. And we have discouraged who has not done that. So this is something. We have this red, yellow, green badge in company. And we give them green badge when they do good. When they don't, then we escalate with red and yellow badges. Then the normal practice, it should not be like a rule. It is for everybody's safety. So it should become in a culture. So when you have a trust culture, and this is what in Hella we have, we are a great place to work company since many years now, in the top 50 also. So what we do is, rather than dictating these rules, I think we do it in a town hall. So we do a lot of town halls. And blue collars are divided into 10 each. And there's a coordinator. And every day, everybody has to update himself how things are going on, what is wrong, what is right, what, who needs what. And this coming together, I think the culture saves us. Culture is very important. So these groups together then becomes like a war room. And we have a very strict protocol. But these protocols are considered more like our own way of living in the COVID time. Whether it is as soon we get into the plant, whether it is about the thermometer, whether it is about the sanitizer everywhere, whether it is about the distance, we have changed the whole assembly lines with a lot of distances. We have the partitions in between. And with a lot of these hard efforts, we are still running the factory. Same thing we are doing with our retailers and distributors. So for retailers, we have made those transparent separators given to them. It's a multifaceted activity with what we are trying to do. But at the end, it's a war. It's a very difficult thing. And I must say, everyone, be very, very careful. Personally, I am now, this is ninth day I'm recovering. And I can tell you, this is a very difficult process. Mentally, we all have to be very, very strong. That's why I say, why not I also engage with you? It actually works on your mind quite a lot, quite a lot. And in the current scenario and scare is so much. So I think let's everybody talk to each other as much as town halls, meetings, and the protocol, whatever is there. We have a checklist, and that checklist is getting checked every morning, evening. And then also, of course, we are a global company, so it goes to Germany. What all is happening is reported well. So I think corporates are managing it well. I only request and hope and appeal everyone that let's follow the social distancing. Let's follow the mask. Mask is very important. Mask has saved many, many people. So I think mask is critically important. The right mask, maybe double mask. In factory also, we have all masks. I know it is inconvenient, but it's a must. It's a lifeline. Similarly, the sanitizer and the washing the hand. I think these are few like SMS, simple things, but it saves us.
So, you know, one final question. You are known as a man with a big heart, and your company does a lot of CSR activity. In this time, in the second wave, what are the specific CSR activities that you're undertaking?
I think if you look at the biggest thing, what we could manage within our own circle of influence is the blue collars, supporting the blue collars. Because blue collars are losing trust all the time. Last time also, this wave also. So I think for us, it was important to service them, to make them comfortable, give them that trust. This is where we are working very hard. Globally, we are doing a lot of other aspects like ventilator manufacturing in the other counterpart of our company. Similarly, mask manufacturing. So these are some of the activities which we started.
So thank you, Mr. Ravishankar Pandey, for this very interesting interaction. Thank you for sharing, you know, the challenges with the road safety ecosystem in the country, why we need to focus on crash analysis, road design, why we need to get corporates need to take a leadership role in getting their people to follow the seven principles, and also for sharing with us, you know, the work that the FICCI committee is doing in the three streams there. And most importantly, thank you for sharing how in these difficult times you are following checklists, enabling not only your workers to keep safe, but also your distributors by providing them the shield. And of course, the tremendous amount of CSR work that you're focusing on in the blue collar workers. Thank you for joining us today and wish you a very, very speedy recovery so you can be, you know, in the forefront again.
Bye-bye.